Praise the Lord, everybody. Amen. You know, I know last night I was kind of joking about your dear pastor and his voice, but now I'm truly envious. I say, how do you come behind that voice? So I'd rather him come behind me than I have to come behind him. So just want to let you know that I was so glad today in being here with you today. I got to try that, and then if I can get my Hispanic accent really good, then I'm really on point. But then you have Thompson, Pastor Thompson. So it's a Jamaican name there, right there. Yeah, yeah. Wow. I'm so happy to be here with you tonight. I had a wonderful, wonderful experience today. And some of you may be saying, well, what experience is that? My experience today was being in heat. I mean, I just kept hitting people on Facebook and online today just simply saying I've been enjoying this weather. Some say that it's real nice where I am right now in Maryland, But the heat is nice. I like the heat. And then it started tapering down real nice, and nice wind, and I almost moved here. Until I recognized my wife is still at home. So we're good. I just want to just thank God for this opportunity. And so I'm going to ask if you just bow your heads right where you are as we expect to be in line with the Holy Spirit. Is that all right? Father, again, we come before you thanking you for this opportunity of just being in this place. And we're asking now that as we talk a little bit about your word, that we'll hear from you and you alone. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, I really enjoy the word. I love the word. I think and I believe that when you read the word, with the spirit in mind, then you come to the understanding of what God is saying for your life, not just for everyone else. It becomes personal for your own life. And as I was going over yesterday's sermon, just going over it in my head, I've recognized that all God is trying to do is be one with us. That's it. And when I look at this, I've also recognized that in his word, he gives it to us so that we'll understand his character. And in his character, we know some way, somehow, that God just wants to be with us. Then as you read in the newspaper, let's just say you're not looking at the word. You're not reading the Bible at all. Somewhere down the line, you know that something's coming. I mean, some people may say to themselves, well, Pastor, I don't read the Bible, but when I look at what's going on in this world today, I know that something's coming. I want to be clear with you. Something is coming. Someone is coming, and he's coming back for us. Amen? I've got to tell you that there's nothing that I want to keep me here when he comes back. And I need you to know that we're almost home. We're almost what, everybody? We're almost home. Now, I don't know about you, but at home, and when I say home, I'm not talking about Maryland. I'm talking about New York. When we talk about New York and you're at school, I'm talking to maybe the younger ones, but when you're at school and the snow starts falling and it starts accumulating, I thought you was my older brother. You look just like my older brother. I took a double take, like, that's my older brother. Man, I thought it was my older brother. Wow. I'm okay, all right. I mean, he's alive, you know what I mean? He's not like, all right, good. Just, wow, man, you look just like Gary. Come here for a second, real. You think I'm kidding me? You know, you look just like my older brother. Wow. Okay, you know, they told me I can't pass this point right here, so I got to stay right here. My brother is as, not big, large, but as, no, my brother's right. And then he's also, you know, stocky, you know what I mean? Not fat, I said stocky, you know what I mean? Husky. So I kind of miss him. I haven't seen him in a long time. So, hey, brother. You know what I mean? All right. Dude, good. It's a big guy. What do you call a bouncer? Amen. For Jesus. Amen. So here it is now that we're going home. And while we're going home, I want to share the story with you. Well, as we're going home in the snow, we used to walk 8 blocks. So when the snow starts accumulating, we hit the 3rd block, and then the 4th block, and then we hit the 7th block. And when we know we have 1 more block left, all we're thinking to ourselves is that we are almost home. Now, I want to share this with you, and that's how the Holy Spirit works. I could remember, because you're going to hear it again on Sabbath, I could remember when the snow was coming up. One time we were walking home from school, like Pastor Lafitte and myself went to the same school, and while we're on our way from school, the snow now reached about 4 feet. And as we're walking, we came out of the train, and then we're just about to walk the 8 blocks. And my older brother said to us, listen, I don't want you guys to mess up your pants at all. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to walk first. And as I walk first, you follow my steps. And I could remember that as plain as day, that as he was walking and he was walking, his pants up to here was getting wet, but mine was dry. And then my other brother behind me, his was dry also. And when I say that, when someone sees danger ahead, stay with me now, when someone sees danger ahead and says, I'll take the brunt of it so that you'll be safe, that's the one I want to follow. You don't know where I'm going. Come on now. I'm talking about an older brother that's willing to take the brunt of your stuff. I want you to know that this week I want to introduce to you an older brother, come on, named Jesus, who is taking the brunt of your stuff. When I look at this, I recognize that there are always these little stories in the Bible that helps us to understand that God can take us from sin to salvation. Come on now. I believe that God can take us from sin to salvation. That's the kind of God that we serve. There is nothing that you have ever done in your life so crazy that God doesn't understand. Listen, anybody who's crazy enough to get off their throne and die for me can understand you're crazy. Anyone who would die on a cross that did not do anything wrong, that's crazy. I'm not dying for none of y'all. I just wouldn't. I'm sorry. I mean, that's my mindset. As I'm thinking about it, if you did something to get in trouble, I'm not backing you up. Let me talk about my second brother, my twin. We're twins. We are identical, except that I look better. As I said, I mean, you know, he's taller than me. He's a little bit younger. He's a little bit taller than me. But taller doesn't mean better. I believe great things come in small packages. You believe that? Anyone 5'2" and under, awesome. Anyone 5'3" and above, we're praying for you. No. In light of this, I have a twin brother who's always getting in trouble. No, when we're growing up, he would get into fights, and then my older brother and myself will always have to fight for him. All the time have to fight for him. But he picks his fights. Come on now. He picks his fights because he knows he has an older brother that's coming behind him. Me, on the other hand, I don't look for my older brother. I just fight. I'm a little chihuahua, man. I'm just ready. I'm ready to go. And I remember one day, there was this guy I just could not beat. Couldn't beat this guy. Oh, my goodness. He's always beating me up, man. Every time I go to the locker, he's pushing me around. So this time, I said, I'm going to tell my older brother. I went to him, I said, Gary, there's this guy. He's always picking on me in school, pushing me into the locker. And he said to me, the next time this happens, just call for me. I was like, oh, like, where are you going to be at? You know, we have different lunch periods. You know, where are you going to be at? So this guy was picking on me, pushed me into the locker, and then had me in a headlock. Yeah, you know, he had me in a headlock. I just couldn't get out. And I just heard this rumbling sound. And my older brother, he's like 6 feet, starts running, picks up the guy, takes him, and I mean, literally slams him on the ground and starts kicking him. I said, wait, Gary, just stop. But when he stopped and everybody was like, oh, I walked away like, that's right. As if I won that fight. I need you to know you got an older brother. That even the fight you're in now that you're losing, did you hear that? Even the fight that you're in, that you're losing right now, call on your older brother. And he'll come, and he'll body slam the devil, and you'll win the fight. I like winning. I don't know about you. All I do is win. I mean, all I like to do is win. Wow, that's for a different generation. Amen, amen. Are we all friends? Are we all good? That sounds like Jesus, though. All I do is win. You know, all I do, even when I lose, I still win. That's like the cross. Even when he seems like he lost at the cross, he still wins. And he has to win, not 2,000 years ago, but today in your lives. My goodness, what is it like and folks, if your parents come home and says, all I do is win, then take them to that song, and then they'll understand. In light of that, turn your Bibles with me, will you? Turn your Bibles with me to Luke chapter 15. Luke chapter what, everybody? Luke chapter 15. Boy, I want you to understand that I'm taking some of these stories because when you come to understand some of these stories in the Word of God, different from how you've read it before, you will realize that we're almost home, and I don't want to miss getting home. I don't want to miss getting home. The Bible tells us in Luke chapter, what everybody? Luke chapter 15, for those who are online, Luke chapter 15, the Bible brings us to this text which says, and then drew near unto him all the publicans and sinners for to do what everybody? To hear him. And the Pharisees and scribes murmured, saying, this man receiveth sinners and eats with them. Oh, wait a second. We're looking at this text again, and this text says, then drew near to him, near to whom, everybody? To Jesus. It says, all the publicans and sinners for to hear him. It says, and the Pharisees and scribes murmured, saying, this man receiveth what? Sinners and eats with them. I want you to look at this picture for a second before we go into this. I want you to know that there's a church service going on the outside. Please, use your divine imagination as you read the Word of God. I always tell people that when you're reading the Word of God, it's like you got to make the movie in your mind. Are you with me? Because I'm going to tell you right now, when I think of the Ten Commandments, the one with Charlton Heston, you know, when I think about that, and I compare it to when I read it, it's not the same. Let me give you an example. Real. This is hot. I keep trying to tell you the Bible is hot. It's hot. It's better than scandal. Listen. It tells, you know, the chariots, this is what the Bible says. The chariots are coming after the children of Israel. Y'all remember that? You remember that? And if you notice that when they were going after the children of Israel, they stopped, you know, like they stopped in the middle of the this is the 1950 joint, right? They stopped and they said, let's go get them. You know, in the Bible, they didn't do that. In the Bible, the Word of God says that the wheels of the chariot got stuck in the mud right then and there. How did they get over on, listen, y'all, check it out. How did they get over on dry land? The children of Israel got over on dry land, but it seemed like as they kept going, it started getting muddy with the last person. Come on, amen, piano. I'm telling you, really? Word? For real? I'm just saying. Because going over on dry land was for the Israelites. So now when the last one goes over, then whatever's behind them, that's on you. And it said in the Bible, it's crazy, the Bible says that their wheels got stuck, that they couldn't move. Now, if they could move, they could go back. Or if they could move, they can go forward, but they all got stuck in mud. And when I look at that, I said, the movie is not what the Bible says. So when I read the Bible, I got to read the Bible and make the movie for me, such as, I love the movie The Color Purple. Oh, I love the movie The Color Purple. I just love it. That's all. I love it. So, but when I read the book and then I watched the movie, I was disappointed. Anybody, right? Anybody, like my wife is into the Hunger Games. My wife is into the Hunger Games. But she gets upset all the time. Why? Because she reads it first, right? Then she goes and watches the movie and says, oh, what a disappointment. It's disappointment because when you read, right? Stay with me now. When you read, you've seen it for yourself. Oh, I can't wait to get here. And then when you see what someone else put together, that was their version. That's why I'm saying don't trust Pastor Graham. It's okay not to trust me. When I read the Bible, I got to read it. Come on now. For me to get an understanding of who he is for myself. Stay with me now. I want you to read it. Come on now. So that you don't go by somebody else's version of who Jesus is. You got to go by your relationship. And so as you read this word, you come to find out who Jesus is. You make the movie in your mind. And here it is now that there's this big church outside. You got Pharisees. Come on now. You got scribes. You got sinners and publicans. Are you with me so far? But the Bible says that the Pharisees and the scribes, I'm sorry, the Bible says that the publicans and the sinners came to hear him. And the Pharisees and the scribes from our church, I mean from the area, I love you. They came to say that this man eats with sinners. Now, let me be clear, Pastor. I want you to know that your pastor is interested in sinners. If I'm saying it, if Pastor Lafitte, if all of your pastors are not interested in sinners, then they're in the wrong business. Come on now. I live to meet sinners. I live to meet sinners. Why? Because someone saved me. Listen, can I share something with you? The only reason why I'm a pastor is so I can get to heaven. Are you with me? This is, I'm trying to tell you that if you were not a pastor, you'd probably be a DJ. And I don't mean from a Christian station either. I'll be that dude saying, and yeah, the next song that's coming up is so-and-so. Shake your, something. I'll be that voice on hip-hop. You know, if I had his voice, that's why God won't give me certain things. If I could sing, I probably wouldn't sing gospel. You mean, Jesus is coming again. I'd be like, that'd be me. That's why God only gave me something. All I could do is preach. That's all. That's all I could do is preach. That's all I got. That's it. So, and because of this, that's my ticket to living right. Can I share something with you? I got fired about 10 years ago, right? It's on the internet. Don't worry about it. I got fired about 10 years ago. It's all right. Many of you got fired before. Anybody ever got fired before? Nobody? Good. Okay. It's one. It's one, two. Okay. I need to. People get fired. I just got fired from pastor. And I said to myself, my goodness, there's nothing else I can do. And there was nothing else I can do. I can't build buildings. I did nothing with my hands because when I was born, watch this, when I was born, I knew what I was supposed to do in my life. There's nothing else I wanted to do. And then because I could not make any money doing anything else, nothing else, I said to my wife, I said, listen, I'm going to McDonald's. I got to make some kind of. She said, no, my husband can't work at McDonald's. I was like, that's money. So what basically happened was, watch this. We're going to talk about humility as we come down to a close. That what happened was I pastored a church as large as this one that had a daycare center. How humbling is it when you lose your job as a pastor and you pastored a church this large, and then you needed a job, so they took you in as the assistant, ready? The assistant teacher to the kindergarten class. Of the daycare of the church. I was once the one that was the head of the board. Now, come on now. Now I'm blowing kids' nose. But I learned how to deal with people with dealing with children. I spent 2 years as an assistant teacher to kids in kindergarten. You should see me in board meeting now. You can't get me upset like in the past. Pastor, you're so-and-so. I just think of the little kids. Okay. I mean, and sometimes when a pastor, I'm not talking about your pastor, I'm not talking about your church, But when people get on your nerves, just to get on your nerves, you think of those little kids because just like God took Moses 40 years with, come on, right? He had to take me to those little kids so that when he gave me the opportunity to pastor again, I'll know how to pastor adults that act like children. So here it is. This is all I know how to do. So the Bible tells us that we're all about sinners. We're all about sinners. We're all about sinners saved by what, everybody? Come on, you know it. Saved by grace. And if we only understood what grace was, that means that anything that you have done in your life that was wrong, anything you have done wrong and you're guilty about it, you have no reason to feel guilty about it because somebody died for your guilt. Somebody died for your guilt. And so here it is now that the Bible is telling us, watch this, the Bible is telling us that you have haughty people coming in church. Now I expect for you to do your homework on this. And the word of God says that the Pharisees and the scribes are in church, come on now, and the sinners are in church, but they're upset at Jesus because he's sitting and eating with sinners, not recognizing that everybody are sinners. But which one of you are saved by grace? We all have sinned and fallen short. I don't like that. And fallen high of the glory of God. Ain't nothing wrong with being short. But I recognize that we've all messed up, even today. Somebody messed up today. But there's still a Jesus today. Come on, the Bible tells us, watch this. The Bible tells us that, and he spake a parable saying unto them, I love these parables. The word of God says, what man of you having 100 sheep, how many sheep everybody? If he lose one of them, doth not leave the what, 99 in the, come on, in the wilderness and go after that one which was lost until he find it. And when he, come on, finds it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he cometh home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying unto them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost. I say unto you right now that there is joy in heaven over one sinner that repents. It did not say the church. Come on now. It didn't say the whole Pathfinder Club. It didn't say your whole block. It didn't say your whole neighborhood. If one person in here tonight, not next week, not Friday, not the end of the revival, come on now, just tonight says, God, I'm going to give myself to you. If we have no fanfare for you in here tonight, thank you. Oh, great that you gave your heart to God. Heaven busts wide open for your decision. That's crazy. I love a party. I mean, even a Christian one. I love a party. I enjoy a party. Isn't it amazing that in Prince's death, everybody's having a celebration, but no one's celebrating the fact that you gave your life to Christ? So if we missed it, check out heaven. If you can see what heaven looks like, just for the fact that some of your hearts are stirring right now. Come on now. You ever try to talk to a young lady? Guys, I'm talking to the guys, because ladies, if you're talking to a young lady, we'll be praying for you. Listen closely. You know, can I get a commercial real quick? Quick commercial, you know, there's gay people in church. Amen? There's gay people in church. Amen? Good. And someone came to me one day and they said to me, how could you let this gay man sing at your church? You know he's openly gay. I said, yeah, but what do you want me to do? He can't sing because he's gay. He can't sing because he's gay, or he can't sing because he's gay and you think he's doing gay things. What's it? Because I'm going to tell you right now, he may be gay, but you have another problem that's still sending you to hell. I mean, I let you read the scripture. I mean, what's the difference between someone being gay? Come on, right? The one thing I like about gay individuals, they at least know they're gay. Some of us don't know what we are. I'm just telling you, if what's your name, sis? I'm not saying you gay. What's your name? Okay, Monique. No, Monique, if you were gay and you came to me and said, listen, I love your church, but they're not going to accept me, then I'm going to simply say that, well, God will. But God will plant. He will. God don't think like us. Let me see. There's no reserve sign. That says there's no reserve sign. This is reserved for the good ones. And this one is reserved for the ones that, even for the Sabbath. Just because we believe in the Sabbath, because we believe in the Sabbath, doesn't mean you got the first ticket to heaven. I got to let you know there's going to be a lot of Sabbath keepers burning, you know. Because we're judging people who we think are sinful. So one sister came to me one time. She says to me, Pastor, I want to thank you for inviting me to your church and so-and-so, but you know that I'm gay. I said, yeah, I know that you're gay. I said, but what is going to be your ministry here? She said, like a ministry? I said, yeah, like a ministry. What are you going to be doing here? And she said, well, I didn't know I could do a ministry. I said, why? She said, because I'm, I said, don't get scared now. You know, you just said, because you are good. Say the word. Now, what I would like, though, that if you know your situation, then we want to be praying for you so that your relationship with God will be where it needs to be, that even if you're struggling in that decision, whether you think you're born that way or, listen, whether you think you're born that way or your environment, that God is going to help you walk through that. Don't ask me because I don't have that kind of mindset. God loves sinners, man. He died for sinners. He said, I came for those. Come on now. who are sinners. So then there's a couple that comes to me, a married couple that comes to me, and they come to me and they said, Pastor, my husband has been cheating. I found something. My husband has been cheating. And I said, okay. And he says, oh, she's been cheating and she's been cheating. They've both been cheating. They've both been cheating. And you're worried about the gay guy. In the book, this is not for the visitors. In the book Evangelism, you know that book, the book that used to be read? Okay, good. In the book Evangelism, it says that every time, watch this, every time that the leaders of the church come together to plan evangelism and someone gets up and says, this can't happen, that they are filled with a demon. Because anytime there's time for evangelism, that there should be no negative thought for evangelism. Man, I'd rather deal with four gay guys on my board than the one individual that's the devil's advocate. Woohoo! We talked about that last night. But I recognize that God is about saving sinners. The Bible tells us, watch this. The Bible tells us that this man has 100 sheep. How many, everybody? 100 sheep. And when he has 100 sheep, watch this now, that one of them leaves. One of them's gone. The sheep is gone. He leaves the 99 and goes for the one that's lost, the one that's gone. Now, I'm going to tell you right now, if I had 100 sheep and one left, he'd buy himself somewhere. Because I'm recognizing that the Bible says that he has to leave. He's got to leave the 99 by themselves. Watch this now. He got to leave the 99 by themselves and then go search for that one. And he's searching for, watch this, he's searching for this one in the wilderness by himself. Remember, the 99 is already in the wilderness and this one is still in the wilderness, but this one's by himself. Now I got to leave them and find you. That means I can get in trouble. But he sacrifices the 99, watch this now, who are together already. That means if somebody gets pregnant in church, right? Because it happens. It happens. Then don't put them out in the wilderness. Keep them in, because there's a lot of y'all that got pregnant that we don't know about. Oh, man, I want to come back here, man. Please, I want to come back. I want to come back, okay? So in light of this, we've got to remember that some people are not doing this, but they're thinking it. What a man thinketh in his heart, so come on now. So is he. Listen, I'm in my hotel room, right? Can we talk? I'm in my hotel room. My wife ain't here. Come on now. My internet works. Are you with me? Anybody with me? My wife is not here. My internet works. I'm getting through an issue in my life. Are you with me? Come on, folks. I'm going through an issue in my life. So I didn't do it yesterday, and I didn't do it last week, and I didn't do it last month. I didn't do it 3 months ago. Are you with me so far? So I'm there by myself, and I got to be in there saying, Lord, do I open this thing? Do I watch what I'm not supposed to watch? It's a struggle every single day. And when I make it through today, come on now. When I make it through today, I'm almost home. Woo! The main thing is you got to recognize that God is about saving every one of us. I may not have your problem, thank God, 'cause I don't know what your problem is. But I got some problem. You got a problem. Don't tell us. You got a problem. My man, you got the CD, you got a problem. You know. We all got problems. But the Bible says that Jesus has left the 99 to take care of one another. And then when he finds this one, he takes it on his back because he knows how we're prone to wander. God ever got you out of something? Ladies, can we talk? God ever got you out of something? You said, Lord, if you get me out of this one, I would never go back to that brother again. And then everything got good, you know what I'm talking about? And then you started calling him again. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? We always go back to our vomit. That's what the word says. We always go back to our vomit. And I need you to know right now that God knows how we're prone to wander. God knows how your hearts right now are not being pricked by the word from the pastor, but it's being pricked by the Holy Spirit. Your hearts, there are people in here right now, your hearts are pricked by the Holy Spirit. But then when you walk out of here feeling good, all you got to get is a phone call or hear this other song or just forget a little bit. Stop at the light, somebody cuss you at the light. All of a sudden, you're prone to wander. So he puts you on his back. Woo! The word says that he puts the sheep on his back and takes them home. Takes them home because I know if I let you walk with me, you're going to go back. Come on now. And then it says, rejoice with me because my sheep is back home. I found the sheep. What's your name, brother? What's your name? Matthew. If Matthew, cool name. If Matthew should leave this church, the church should not function till he gets back. Are you with me? It shouldn't function until he gets back. What I'm saying to you is that Monique, this is your first time here? Second. Second time around. All right, second time. All right, here it is now. If you come to church and no one says anything to you, you leave and we don't know where you are, nothing at all. Man, we have left her into the wilderness. To the wolves. Not the dogs. Dogs are faithful. Wolves. Y'all better show up Wednesday and Thursday. And I want you to understand, don't feel comfortable until you get that one that's lost. Can you think of somebody right now? Can you think of somebody that you wish were here? Come on. Can you think of one of your friends that you wish were here? But I wish they can hear this. No. You tell them. You tell them. They may not accept it from me, but you tell them. You pick up the word of God and you let them know. You are sheep, and sheep. Let me tell you something about sheep. Sheep, they dumb, y'all. Sheep dumb. All sheep do. This is what sheep do. It's like all we do, we all sheep. All we do, we jump off the precipice. One sheep will go and be like, bah. Then the other sheep will go, oh, look, he just fell. Me too. Sheep are just dumb. They're just dumb like that. That's why they need a shepherd. Come on now. That's why they need a shepherd. Huh? I ain't talking about Lafitte, Pastor Lafitte. Pastor Lafitte, he's a good under-shepherd. Come on now. Your pastors are good under-shepherds. We're just good under-shepherds. We whack. Once you start walking with the true shepherd. Man, I want to share this with you, Pastor Lafitte. Pastor Lafitte, I need you to know this. So don't get upset. Don't get upset. And when you drive me home, don't drop me off. Just don't throw me off. But I need you to know, I'm saying this, that I always tell people, when I do workshops, I always tell people that the difference between pastoring now and pastoring before is that I have doo-doo on my shoes. Yeah, I know. It was a little, I'm sorry, doo-doo, crap, It's on my shoe. It's better than the other words. Okay, it's on my shoe. Why do I say that? Because a shepherd walks in the mess of the people that they're shepherding. A shepherd doesn't have clean shoes. And a shepherd knows what it's like to have unclean shoes. That's what I love about God. The Bible says he was tempted in all points, so he knows what you're going through. And then for those visitors that are with us, I was leaving. Pastor Lafitte took me to get the roots. What is that? The roots? The drink from the roots. Smoothies. Yes. When I was walking out, I found a penny. See, I got to be real with you. I got about 7 more minutes. Listen, I got to be honest with you. I don't leave pennies. I pick them up. I'm not cheap. I'm smart. If I see a penny on the floor, if I'm walking, I see a penny on the floor, and be like, I don't even shame. Some people like this. Nah, if I see a penny on the floor, this is me. Because a million of these, I would love in the bank. When we were growing up, Lafitte, we call it the bodega. We call it the local bodega. We go to the local bodega, you see a lot of pennies sitting there. You want to know why? Because when people get change back, they keep all the silver. Come on. They keep all the dimes. They keep all the quarters. And they take the little pennies and they do like this. They let it drop. Because for them, it doesn't mean anything. For God, it does. God takes the time to find these little pennies like you. The devil is telling you this is all you're worth. And God said, well, if it's in my hands, then you're worth more because it's in my hands. And the Bible says that this woman loses a coin. And the word of God says that she turns over the whole house. The original language says she does a spring cleaning just to find one coin. Then when she finds it, watch this. She says, I found the coin that I have lost. She took ownership in losing the coin. She's the woman. Am I correct? In Revelation, the woman is the church. And our churches are losing our precious coins. God is saying that, like this woman found this coin. He says, I just want to find you. And this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to turn over beds. I'm going to turn over clubs. I'm going to turn over relationships. I'll let you lose your job. I'll let you lose that relationship with that fella so I can find you. And when he finds you, he says, look what I found. The part that was missing, now I've got the whole. Don't you want to be whole in Jesus Christ? Don't you? It may not be popular, but it's better to be whole in Jesus Christ than being in a piece of hell. And the Bible takes us to this last story that we're going to be talking about on Sabbath. This last story really is so amazing because the truth of the matter is that God will let us go. He will let us go. And I pause this for a moment to simply say, because if you want to hear the rest of this, you got to be here Sabbath. We're not going to be dealing with this tomorrow. This is Sabbath. But just to give you a taste that you got a young man who says to his father, I'm sick of the rules. And that's why a lot of people don't come to church, because they feel like the church are full of rules. That's why people don't come to church. A lot of people go to non-denominational church because non-denominational church don't really deal with rules. Come on now. A lot of people, listen, please don't stone me. No, don't stone me. I'm almost done, but don't stone me. But if I was not an Adventist, if I was not a Seventh-day Adventist, I'd be a Catholic. Yeah, listen. A lot of us don't understand that. You keep throwing stones at Catholics because Catholics go to church on Sunday. Well, the Catholic is a universal church, and so is the Adventist church. So we're Catholics. Shut up and listen. Catholic means universal. The Seventh-day Adventist church has grown so large right now that it's a Catholic church. That's what the word means. Look it up. Catholic don't mean devil. It means large and universal. That's what the word means. We're also a Baptist church. Did you know that the Adventist church is a Baptist church? We baptize. Did you know that the Adventist church is also a Jehovah Witness church? We witness for Jehovah. Oh, here we go. I need to know we're also Pentecostal. Now, we may not speak in tongues, but in this church you do. I mean, I walked in here 2 days now. I passed by some people. I don't know what y'all saying. You know, me not, I don't know what you're saying. You know what I'm saying? I mean, even some of the West Indians are talking to him like, what you said? That's tongues. Are you with me so far? Where are we? So we're Pentecostal. Are we Pentecostal? We're Church of God in Prophecy, aren't we? Come on, aren't we? We're not? Are we? Aren't we? Hello, aren't we Church of God in Prophecy? Yes, we are. We're all of that, but not everybody is us. So a lot of people don't like the rules. And the reason why you don't like the rules is because you're being introduced to rules and not the ruler. When you come to know the ruler, then you don't mind the rules, because the rules come from the rule book. And the one who made the rules is the ruler, the one that wakes you up each morning. Come on now. The one that sets you on your way, the one that still forgives, the one that transformed you from sinner to saint. That's what the New Testament calls you, saints. Even though you messed up today, you're still a saint. Somebody ought to say hallelujah. And so he simply says, he's only trying to tell the Pharisees that we all are sinners. but saved by grace. I just want to eat with you because we're under the same condition. We're all messed up. We all have fallen short of the glory of God. But when he finds you, all of heaven will be rejoicing for you. Father, thank you for this word. Thank you for the opportunity of understanding that you have paused and partied in heaven for me. And because of this, Lord, I simply want to let you know that we love you. Somebody here loves you, Lord. Somebody here loves you simply because you've accepted them even in their mess. And now, Lord, we simply give ourselves to you and simply said, I can be found. And because we can be found, we give ourselves over to you. Thank you, Lord, for finding us tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Amen.
Pastor.
Oh, I forgot. The hot seat.
What a great message, amen. So now we have the question and answer portion where we will be asking Pastor Graham questions. If you can, you can text any questions now, especially if you're live streaming. They'll have the number up on the screen very soon. It's not too late. Go ahead and text in your questions. We'll begin with the first one. You ready, Pastor Graham?
I think I am.
Okay. While I get it up here, I think I remember the first one. The first one was, if we have a question in the Bible that we do not understand, who do we ask? The pastor, the internet, where do we turn to?
According to the word, we ought to turn to the Holy Spirit. According to the word. A lot of times we have questions. Part of it is, sometimes we're studying the Bible for a certain outcome instead of studying it for edification. If we have a question, iron does sharpen iron. That's what the Word of God says. The iron sharpens iron. So that if there's someone here who may have a question or stuck on something in the Word, you should call someone who is a praying person and call for the Holy Spirit. Just like how demon worshipers call for demons, we call for the Holy Spirit. Amen. And when we call for the Holy Spirit, the Bible says they illuminate our minds, they open our minds. I'm sorry, not illuminate, but they open our minds and lead us. That's what the Holy Spirit does. But sometimes it's a little frightening when we look to others for answers, because a lot of times we answer questions according to our own experiences. But the Word of God, if there's a question that needs to be asked, you want to first pray, ask for the Holy Spirit to illuminate your mind, and find someone who would be willing to pray for the answer, okay? Instead of hearing what somebody thinks, you both are praying, and then iron sharpens iron.
Amen. Okay? Thank you. Next question. How can we open the hearts of those who enforce the rules set in church?
All right, amen. Amen. Listen. I looked right to the pastor. You see, so the last question, it says, do we talk to the pastors? These guys were, you know, all right. I come from a West Indian background. If you notice today, I don't have my ring on. I don't know if anybody noticed that today I did not have my ring on. Because in speaking to you, and there may be visitors here, I felt in some way that because of the church that I was coming to, that I didn't want anyone to be a stumbling block for someone else. That's growth in one day. Are you understanding where I'm coming from? It's growth in one day. Those who give the rules, give it according to the way they understand the rules and the way they were taught. And you can't fault anyone for that, because that is the lenses that they were brought into the church with, or how they've come to understand their religion. The tough thing that I'm going to say is, that people are stuck on rules because they're stuck on religion. Rules are made based on principles that comes from the Word of God. If it comes out of someone's lenses, then it's not the Word of God. If our individuals who are teaching certain rules are not proving it from the Word of God and even the spirit of prophecy, then it's somebody's mindset. And I'm going to give you an example. When I was growing up, we did not have drums in church. Are you with me? I saw a drum set up here yesterday. I seen it. When I was growing up in the 80s, that was sinful. Now, you can have an acoustic guitar, but you couldn't have an electric guitar. Anybody with me so far? Anybody remember that? Okay. And then ministers in the 60s were not allowed to wear beards. They had to be clean shaven. Where did that come from? Where did some of these rules come from? I'm going to scare you a little bit. I'm going to frighten you a little bit. When I was raised in the Adventist church, when it came to communion time, we were told we had to be baptized before we did the ordinance of humility. Are you with me, folks? I also told you had to be baptized before you were able to take the communion. Are you with me, folks? It was only 3 years ago when my children talked to me and asked me where did it come from that I couldn't answer it. And I'm on my 23rd year in ministry, which means that we need to start teaching our children what the Word says and not what we believe that comes from tradition, though traditions are good and they're great. There's something that I want to share with you, that we have guardrails. That's what I love about our church. Our church have guardrails. Are you with me, folks? And it's okay to have guardrails. But when the guardrails are set up so that we won't have further understanding, then there's a problem. But if the guardrails are set up so that if we jump over the rules, there's the precipice, then we recognize that these guardrails are put up so that we will be safe. I would say to those individuals who are still putting these rules in place without the biblical mindset or the biblical principles, that we're hurting the next generation and hurting the individuals who are coming in, recognizing that Christ is truth. When we do that, then we chase too many people away from what's greater than what's less. So in order for our steadfast individuals to think differently, their rules must come from the rule book. That's it, right? And may I add, please don't say it's older folks. It's not older folks. My church is a church of millennials. And I'm going to tell you, I was telling the pastor Lafitte that I was talking to them about tithe and what tithe is really about and what the storehouse really is. And I almost got stoned by 20-something-year-olds. So it's not an age difference. It's an education from the Word of God difference. Okay? So please, it's not old folks. Please. I'm sorry. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Okay. How can I get released from all anger and hatred against someone who have hurt me? I want to, but it's hard to fully let go of the feelings.
The Bible tells us that you can't say you love God and not love your fellow man. The Bible calls you a liar. That's what the text says. But then if you cannot love someone and can't forgive someone, then how could you be at the tree of life together? Great Controversy tells us, for those who are visitors with us, we really believe that there was a certain time in our, not in our church history, but before our church history, right? That a little lady was given some insight and wrote a book called The Great Controversy. Are you with me? In The Great Controversy, it says that before we get to heaven, we would have to have become overcomers over certain things. Let's say the Great Controversy wasn't there, and let's go right to the Word of God. The Bible says that we ought to forgive our debtors, as we have been forgiven. And it's difficult to forgive someone when you see them and all you can see is the hurt that they've done to you. But if our God can forgive us for the stuff we've done over and over and over again, he's only asking you to put on his character and forgive also. But how do you do it? I'm sorry. I believe that was that smoothie, man. God wants us to take it to him in prayer. There's a beautiful song that says, what a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and grief to bear. All because we do not carry to God in prayer. I declare to you that the reason why you're holding on to that stuff is because you didn't bring it to God yet. You didn't bring it to God yet. Because once you bring it to God, he's going to bring you through that thing. But there's certain things you're going to hear. You're going to always hear me say that. Bring it to God. Bring it to God. I was talking to somebody on the phone today, and I said to them, I could be a better individual if I had more patience in my prayer life. I'm not talking about praying. I'm talking about really bringing some stuff to God, making the list out to God. But my mindset, because I've grew up into this thing, that I feel like God knows everything already, right? So he should know how I feel. But he's saying, take it to me. I want to hear your heart. But my microwave society says that I just want God to, come on, give me the results, give me the results. And God is saying, I can give you the results if you give me what's on your heart. And I believe that if you talk to God about it, everything, bring it, everything to God in prayer, he's going to answer you. And you can let go of that. Can I share something with you? When you hold on to that stuff, it really messes you up physically. It messes you up physically. That thing messes you up physically. Once you start forgiving someone, you're not freeing the other person. You're freeing yourself. Yo, I got one more thing over there. The person that was a part of me losing my job years ago. And I bring it up because I want you to know that you're talking to someone who's been restored. Amen. Is that all right? Yeah. Okay. And it may not have been a big deal. If I tell you the story, it probably may not be a big deal to you because it's not what happened that you may think was the big deal. But sin is sin, no matter how small it is. Even in conversation. Are you with me so far? My wife said to me one time, what if this person walked into our church, sat down? What would you do? And I said, I don't know. Because I was not presented with that at this point. But if so, I should be at a point where I should forgive that person. Because heaven is bigger than your mindset. And I haven't reached there yet. But I know this much, that if God has forgiven me of my sins, every one of them, then I should be able to forgive someone else for something that's not that deep in God's hands. Okay? And whoever that individual is, my email is paulgraham70@gmail.com. paulgraham70@gmail.com. You email me and we're going to have a conversation about forgiveness. Free yourself from that foolishness. Okay?
So many questions. We only have time for one more.
Okay.
Per Pastor Marsh, don't blame me.
Okay, good. the culprit.
Okay, this question. I'm tempted to be intimate with my boyfriend, but I haven't. I'm going to read it as it says. Mm-hmm. But I haven't do it. I guess I haven't done it.
Mm-hmm. Besides praying. Okay, I'm going to be a little candid, but the kids are playing. The kids are in there. Okay. Oh, how old are you? 12. I'm fine. My cousin got pregnant at 12. Listen closely. When we do what we do in an intimate manner, look it up on Google. Don't look for the pictures. Look it up on Google. That moment that we're doing what we're doing, that moment, that explosive moment, are you with me? Is 6 seconds. That's it. You could do whatever you're doing for 30 minutes, 40 minutes, if you're real good for an hour. You know. It all ends for that 6 seconds of that last explosive pleasure. Are you with me? That person who asked me this, listen closely. The issue is that you have to compare 6 seconds to eternity. When you look at 6 seconds of pleasure and eternity of pleasure, which one do you want? Which one's worth more? And when you look at this, you have to ask yourself the question that you don't think of these things during that time, but then you also have to think of the fact that that person is becoming you according to the Word of God. And if that person is becoming you, then the truth of the matter, if we're living in those days, that person would be married to you. And no matter how many times he's been with someone else, you don't want to be married to 6 other people. So before you think of the excitement of the intimacy, think of the one who really wants to be intimate with you forever. And it's Jesus Christ. And don't miss the mark. It feels good. Sex feels good. It's good. It's awesome. I'm not trying to, you know, it's a spiritual thing. God made it. And what God made is always good, and the devil is always trying to bring something else to make it. But it's just that you're not ready for that power yet. And when you're ready, sometimes you'll miss church for it. In marriage. Amen? 6 seconds. Eternity. Which one do you rather have? Okay.
Thank you, Pastor Graham. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. We ask that you come back again. If you're live streaming, join us again. I hope everyone was able to log in. Yes, it was great. Awesome. If you had a great time today, give a round of applause. Amen. Let us stand up as we close in prayer.
Let's bow our heads together. Father, again, we come before you, first of all, thanking you for this opportunity of getting into your word. Yesterday, we looked at Luke chapter 8. We recognize you're an all-powerful God. We're going home. And then today, we looked at Luke chapter 15. We recognize we've all are sinners saved by grace. We're still going home. But then as we go home today and we talk to you, we're recognizing that we're almost home. Now, as we leave this place, we ask you to take us to our destination safely with no hurt, harm, or danger. And for those whose hearts are pricked to give themselves to you, give them no sleep until they give themselves to you. Wrestle with them. Wrestle with us as we come to know you as a true God in our lives. Before we close this prayer, we want you to know that we love you, Lord, and we appreciate you being the God of our lives. Bless us in Jesus' name. Amen.